I thought it was. That bell we'll put on our table with the boombox.
Good morning to all of you, and thank you for being here today. I know the family appreciates all of you that are here from the Coach Grove Fire Department and representing EMS and the chaplains and those that are here, as well as all the family, extended family. I am Pastor Eddie White, and it is an honor for me to serve this family and lead them in the celebration of the life of William Edward Coates, better known as Mr. Bill. So I'll just call him Mr. Bill, because you knew him as Mr. Bill, and the community knew him as Mr. Bill. I think some of those nicknamed him Coatsy when they called him that way. But and then as we shared some stories and things, he was kind of known as Mr. A1. Understood that he enjoyed and liked A1 sauce on just about anything and everything. And so when you, next time you're eating a steak or you're using A1, think of Mr. Bill and how much he loved it and how much he cared for it and how much it meant to him. There are many reasons we can gather together from day to day and families and things, and certainly during this pandemic crisis that all of the whole world and our nation as well is going through, we're having to limit our gatherings. But we're here today to gather, and for several reasons, certainly to acknowledge the sense of loss and sorrow and grief that this family is going through, that they are facing, JM, and for Charles and Jerry and for Corrine, all of them and all of the family, everyone, and you that knew him from the community and you that served with him in the fire department and the EMS in the public work that you did. Certainly there is a feeling there and an emptiness that is there. We're also here to seek the comfort that family brings to one another and the gathering brings to one another, and certainly the friends that have expressed, and already many have called or they've come by and let this family know how much you're thinking of them, and there'll be even more in the future. But we're also here to seek the comfort that God brings and God offers to us. Brother Mr. Bill knew and had a relationship with his Heavenly Father through his relationship, through his acceptance of Jesus as his Savior. And I'll make a little more reference to that in a little bit, but we know that God is here with us. And your presence as family, your presence as community members, your presence as those that serve with him in the public capacity of the EMS and fire department is a gift to this family. And God's presence is a gift today. And we're grateful for that, and we thank the Lord for that. Let me just share a scripture or two that is intended to bring us some encouragement and lift our spirits and our hearts up. If the wind will cooperate with me and my two hands that I need maybe four, but two will have to do with what I have. In Isaiah 41:10, God says, do not fear, for I am with you. There's that presence we talked about. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And then the writer in Romans chapter 8 said, for Paul said, for I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, neither angels nor demonic powers, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Mr. Bill experienced the love of God in his faith with the Lord. He is not absent from the love of God, but he is enjoying the fulfillment of that love. Though he is absent from you, the children, you, the family, and the community of Coates, and all of us that knew him and have been acquainted with him, but the love of God is still there, and the love that he had for God and the love that he lived for God is with you as well. Psalm 31, 34, 18 said, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are down and who are broken in spirit." Certainly, the walk through the valley of the shadow of death brings us into a sense of brokenness. Brokenness of the family and the circle of the family and the enjoyment of the presence of our loved one that has left us. But we know by his own testimony that he is absent from this body, but he's present with the Lord. And we know that even though we feel crushed, that God will mend and God will touch and God will bless the grieved hearts. May we have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you today that we can call upon you and know that you are listening. Know that you are ready to answer in your loving grace and your loving power and strength, O Lord, to bring the added strength that, Lord, this family needs, his sons and this daughter, Lord, the extended family, Lord, and for even those of the family that could not come, his brother there in Virginia, that, Lord, you will just lift their spirits up and their hearts up. As many prayers have been going out for them, Lord, and lifting them up, Lord, we continue to pray for them today and are grateful and thankful that, Lord, we, Lord, are here, Lord, to celebrate the life of Mr. Bill. And to Lord, to dedicate ourselves, Lord, that in every thought of him and remembrance of him in the future, we will continue to celebrate him. For he ever lives, Lord, because he lives in the memory and the love in the hearts of this family and those who knew him. We give thanks to this, Lord, and give you praise in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. To the words of the song. Thank you. sweet.
The sound that saved a wretch like me.
Well-known songs and well-appreciated songs, but one that speaks of that grace that Mr. Bill experienced and knew in his own heart and life, that he appreciated that tide of grace that reached him, and the same tide of grace that can reach your heart and mine and still reaches us. And until we gather where he is in the presence of the Lord, that grace God promises will be a sufficient agent in our work, in our lives, working for us and blessing us. When death came to Mr. Bill just a few days ago, it took away the bodily form of this man and this one so well known and loved. A man with a smile that was infectious. If you didn't want to smile when Mr. Bill came around, that smile of his would just make you smile anyway. You might go right back to your grin or to your sadness or your frown when he got gone, but when you saw Mr. Bill, he would bring a smile, and he would smile with you, and he would greet you. And so as we talked the other day, the family, we talked about his life a lot. You know, when the body is silent and we place it in his place of rest, and the spirit and soul go with the Lord, it is those memories that you hold in your mind. It is that love you hold in your heart that is so valuable and becomes even more precious and valuable as the days and the years will go on in your life until that appointed time for you and I when we leave this life and we go to be with the Lord. It is our faith that helps us realize that to be absent from the body is to be in the Lord's presence and to be in His keeping, and know that as you have faith, as Mr. Bill had faith, you will see him again, and you will see him in that new body, in that new heaven, that new earth. While on this earth, Mr. Bill lived his life, and as we talked about it, you know, one of the things that came to my mind after I left the family and talking to them was, you know, Mr. Bill lived his life with some fullness. You know, some people live kind of shallow, but he lived with fullness. He lived with the fullness of a desire within him and birth within him. I don't know when exactly came, maybe when he was born, or maybe as a small child and a boy growing up in this area, maybe when he got older. But there was within him a desire to serve, and he joined the U.S. Air Force and became a member of the armed forces and served until his retirement. I believe it was about 1975, we talked about 27 years he served in our armed forces, and that is a very commendable aspect and a commendable thing of his life that we want to remember. But his service did not end, and his spirit of service, his desire of service did not end there just with his retirement from the Air Force. He joined the fire department, EMS, part of the county of Harnett, and there not just 20 years or 25 years, but for 30 years. He served faithfully in going and riding that truck all hours of the day and the night, and working with those in the department and younger men. And we see some younger ones out here today that are being a part of that. And that's commendable and all. That spoke to me of a man that was willing to live his life not for the fullness of himself alone and for his family alone, but he lived it for his community. He lived it for those around him. If we talk about Mr. Bill, we thought about some words such as he was dedicated and thoughtful. He was very helpful. He was serving and a servant to his family and to his friends and to his community. He was caring. He had a level of commitment that kept him and aided him through his years as a U.S. Air Force member, as well as in the 30 years that he served the community of Coates in the EMS and fire department. He had a good work ethic, and he enjoyed working. And he passed that on as we talked about it. And I told them of the statement that I often use in these services, that, you know, the fingerprints of your life don't fade from those you have touched. And he passed on those fingerprints of the work ethic and the life and the appreciation that he had. He enjoyed being involved in helping people. I pray that more of us will have that kind of desire, that we help one another. And certainly in the situation that we have found our nation and so many others across the globe are, it's a time to be less selfish. It's a time to be more thinking of others. Even you say, well, we've got to be distant from people, but you can still be thinking of others. You can still be there for them if they need you. You can still be in contact. You can still minister and help in their lives and bless them and lift them up and be courteous to them and supportive to them and loving to them and kind to them. He had both a temporal and a life of family as well as a spiritual life. He enjoyed fishing and he enjoyed going, and we talked a little bit about his fishing and his going there, and even in the service when he was in Europe and other places, he enjoyed European racing and drag racing, and he enjoyed racing here. Saw some of the pictures the family had submitted and saw him there standing with the race cars and having his pictures, and he enjoyed that sport and all. And now with most of these sports being canceled, I know there's still some races they've got going on in May they hope they can carry out and have. I had a friend that loves it and told me yesterday, he said, I still got my tickets for Martinsville and I'm just believing I'm going to be able to go. And I said, well, I hope you can too. And he said, I got one left. You want you to go, preacher? I said, well, I said, I'm not saying I won't go. I said, but sometimes my schedule, especially on a weekend, doesn't allow me to do those things. He loved gospel music. We heard that song Amazing Grace, and there's another one or two we're going to listen to in a moment or two, but he enjoyed those words, and he enjoyed the lyrics, he enjoyed the tunes, he enjoyed the message of what the gospel said to him, and what it said to his spirit, it said to his heart. And when I was, his brother was not able to come from Gloucester, Virginia to be with us, but he shared with me a little story. He said, we were called the Coach Brothers when my brother Cheryl and he said, and Bill and I formed a singing group, and we went out and we sang at churches and all, and said, everybody called us the Coach Brothers. He said, I don't know if it was that official, he said, but that's who we were, because we were the brothers and we were all coach. Mm-hmm. And so we were the Coach Brothers. But he had a love for that and a desire for that. It's these things that I share with you today that I seek to stir your memory and the reflections you have in your spirit and your heart. For there in your heart are those memories and the love that Mr. Bill gave to you and he shared with you, and not only to his children, but he shared to others around. He shared to his friends, his co-workers. He shared to those that served with him in the fire department and the EMS of Harnett County. He shared himself in ways, invested himself in ways. You know, some people are blessed with a lot of money to invest, or maybe a lot of other things to invest. But most of us maybe don't have that, but we do have our love. We do have the care that we can invest in one another, and we certainly can invest in our loved ones. And I commend Mr. Bill for not only that smile he had and that commitment he had to serve, but for the investment he made in people's lives. I want to tell you, I believe that our first responders, like these young men and men that are here today, and young ladies that serve there as well, that we call them heroes, and they are heroes in a lot of ways, because it is very important that they invest, and what they're doing is investing in our welfare. And in those midnight hours when we need help, they respond. They're there in times like this when they're called to be on the front line. Even in the midst of this pandemic, they are there and they are willing to go. And we appreciate that for these that are present today, but we appreciate it for the memory and the investment that Mr. Bill made, and that he shared of himself, and this family was willing to let him share and do that and all. And I know Charles has followed him in that way as he is serving as well in the forefront of that. And maybe you don't feel led to do that way, but there are other ways you can serve and other places you can go forward and you can be a part of, and you can take your talent and take your fingerprints and you can place them in the lives of people individually and collectively, your family, your friends, and even in your community. You can serve there and you can be a blessing. I enjoyed a phone conversation I had with his brother Danny there in Gloucester, Virginia. And we talked a little bit, and he said, "I sure appreciate you calling, pastor or preacher." He said, "Because I love my big brother." He said, "That's what I called him. He was my big brother." He said, "There were a number of years between our ages," he said, "but he was a big brother to me, and he was a mentor to me. He was an example to me," he said. "And as soon as I was out of high school," he said, "I joined the Air Force too. And I served in the Air Force just like he did. And I went, and though we were sometimes, I was in, I was maybe in Texas, and maybe he was somewhere else, or he was in somewhere else, and I was somewhere else," he said. "I was in communication," and he said, "Maybe it wasn't the right thing to do," he said, "but I'd use that phone we had, and I'd communicate where he was, and we'd be able to share and talk things about where we were in our lives and all." He said, "I sure appreciated that, and how he influenced my life, all of my life." And he said, certainly that he enjoyed the friendship, and not only the family relation, but the friendship they had, and they enjoyed together as brothers, and as they served together as brothers, and as they did together and all. And he said, he was someone that was always lifting him up and would always encourage him. And that's what the kind of influence we can have and we can go forward. He did, as I mentioned, he talked about he and Cheryl, his brother, who was a late brother Cheryl, he and Danny and Mr. Beal sang together. He said that was something we enjoyed doing. He said, because we all committed our lives to the Lord at about the same time. He said, and the little church that we attended and we went to, the pastor there was Pastor Pete Davis. He said, and Pete Davis, pastor, was going to have a baptismal service. And so he said, Cheryl and Beal and I decided we're going to get baptized, and that's going to be a part of our testimony. He said, and so we went down and to an old pond right there in the outskirts of Coates. He said, and we waded out in the water. He said, and there was Pastor Pete. He said, only trouble was Pastor Pete was a real short fella. And here we were retired fellas. And he said, Bill and Cheryl and I looked at one another and said, "I sure hope the preacher don't lose us in the water. I hope he don't drop us when he gets us down there, but gets us back up." Well, he did get them back up. He said, but that was a wonderful thing. He said, "I've always remembered of how we all committed our lives to the Lord Jesus, and how we all went down and we were baptized there together in the same service as a testimony to what God had done in our lives and certainly for us." And he said, "And I'm comfortable today, but though I cannot go and my heart is saddened," he said, "I know that he's at home in heaven, and I know he's there," he said, "and I want to tell my family." And he said, "Preacher, will you tell him this?" And I told him I would. And I'm telling you this from your Uncle Danny. And I'm telling you this from whatever relationship you had with him as a family member, and you that are co-firemen and co-EMS with him and community members. He said, "I want all of you to follow what Bill did and I did and Cheryl did and accept Jesus into your heart and allow him to become your Lord and your Savior." He said, "Preacher, you think that would be out of order?" I said, "No, sir." I said, "If there's more time for you and I to think about our own mortality, it is today. It is at this moment and this time. We're celebrating his life, but we must remember that our life goes on. And celebrating his life goes on every time you remember him when you get that bottle of A1. And he always said, "Has anybody got any A1? I don't know if it was when he went to the restaurants and he went to somebody's house or wherever. And it wouldn't surprise me if maybe he might have carried a bottle. Maybe had a bottle. And if there's any A1 in heaven, Bill will find it, probably. You reckon he will?
Yep.
He'll know if it's there. He'll know it's there. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's listen to the words of another song this time. Sister Rose was placing his hands and living into the words of those songs and placing it there. There's one verse of scripture I felt impressed, and I'm not going to preach a sermon to you. I just want to remind you some words of Jesus. In John's Gospel, chapter 16, and verse 33, Jesus said, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have times of tribulation, and times like this when you lose your loved ones. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." Jesus said, first of all, "I have spoken." The Word of God is real, and God speaks. Though there are then those in the world who may make fun of us who believe in the Word of God and the Bible, and God speaking to us personally. Mr. Bill believed it, celebrated and lived it in his spiritual life and his service in the church. He loved his church and he loved being there. He loved worship. He loved the Word. Not only does the Lord speak and give us his Word, but he says there is a place and a position that is in him. For he says that in me and in him. Mr. Bill discovered, and along with Danny telling me today, and for Cheryl and probably other members of their family, there were several that they found a position in Jesus. And as Danny had said to me, and I invited you, find your place in Jesus. And let Jesus be in you, and you be in Jesus. Let him truly be your Savior, your Lord, and bring salvation to your heart and to your life. Then he said that you might have peace. The Lord is the giver of peace. Jesus said, "I give you peace, not the world gives, but I give you my peace." You see, the world cannot match the peace. Though the world may silence its guns and its wars at times, yet the world cannot touch the inner peace that a soul needs. Only Jesus can give that peace we seek. Certainly in this time that we're in now, there are many who are seeking in the uncertainty of the impact of this pandemic upon us. They're seeking a hope, a peace. For you and I who are believers, we have responsibilities. Let's live that peace. Let's let the watching world find and see the peace of Jesus in us. And he said, you're going to be some tribulation and tough times. The psalmist said, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me." The best thing about that statement is the Lord is with you. Another statement is, a shadow can only exist. These that are standing out from under this tent, that are standing in the sun there, their shadow is there. And the only reason that shadow is there is because there's a greater light in that sky. And that greater light is the sun. And the reason the light shines in you and I is because the light of the world, Jesus Christ, shines in us. It shone in Mr. Bill's life. You saw it many times. You heard it many times. When he led you in worship, when he led the family in prayer, when he said the blessing for the meal, or in any ways you saw in his character and life. Hallelujah. The light that shined that got him through the tough times. And then Jesus said, we can be of good cheer because he has overcome and given victory over the world. Thank the Lord for that today. We're not here to think about the sadness only and to think about the loss only. We're not here to think about being defeated. We're here to celebrate the victory that Mr. Bill received and had in Jesus when he lived here, and that he received in fullness whenever the Lord spoke his name and the angels carried him away into the presence of the Lord. Thank God, hallelujah, for that testimony. And I challenge all of you hearing me today to receive Christ as your Savior and find him as Lord. And if you don't know him, see me, or find a good church, a good pastor, or one of these family members and talk with them, for they know the Lord and will serve him. One more song before we have the military honors in just a few moments following my benediction and committal, and then the honors of the EMS and fire department.
Some bright morning when this life is over, I'll fly away celestial shore. Of this
As it pleased God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of William Edward Coates. We knew him and you knew him as Mr. Bill and Dad and brother and uncle. We therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust, looking for and believing for that general resurrection in the last day and in the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ. When the corruptible bodies of those who have died in him shall be changed and made like unto his own glorious body. Join me for a prayer of benediction. Our gracious Father, again, we ask for your touch into the depth of every heart of these sons and this daughter, and this family, Lord, and for, Lord, this whole community, Lord, and Lord, we'll miss Mr. Beale. Lord, touch and lift up every spirit and heart. Lord, undergird and be close, Lord, when they call upon you. Lord, when they feel sadness overwhelming their spirit, may, Lord, you bring a gladness to them that, Lord, they know is from you, Lord, and that, Lord, strengthens them and blesses them. We ask these things and believe them done in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Please rise for the rendering of military honors. Present. Halt! Thank you. States, the United States Air Force, and the grateful nation. Please accept this flag as appreciation for your loved ones' honorable and faithful service.
I knew him as Bill. A lot of people say Mr. Bill. I knew him as Bill or Chaplain. We served together at the fire department. Some years ago, about 12 years ago, I felt God calling me to do more in my community. So I walk in the Coates Fire Department, and who did I see? Jay. So I asked Jay, I said, Jay, you know, I'd like to serve as your chaplain. He said, well, we have a chaplain already, but, you know, I said, well, can I leave you my number just in case, you know, I can help out some kind of way. In about 2 weeks, I got a call to go up there to meet with the committee. I did, and they brought me on. And I believe Bill had a lot to do with this. He and I had a lot of interesting conversations about the ministry, because this is a ministry. We serve this fire department. They're our family. They're our church, our ministry. And Bill not only felt it important to serve this fire department, but he also visited many other fire departments. When there was a death or something, he called me and he said, you want to go? And I said, yeah. So, you know, I was ready to go whenever he was. So he thought it was important to serve, and I think he lived a legacy and a life of service. You can see that in things that he did with his life. So we need to ask ourselves sometimes, what is my legacy? What am I going to leave for my family to follow behind? That's what a legacy is, isn't it? Something that we see someone did with their life, and we see that maybe that was a good thing. Let's do what he did. Let's follow him, because what he did was a great thing. He served his community, he served his family, he served his country. So we need to keep that in mind, that Bill was a good man. He did a lot for his country, for a lot for his church. He served God, and I believe God's saying, well done, my faithful servant, right now. So let us say the EMS prayer, and I'll close in prayer. As I perform my duty, Lord, whatever be the call, help to guide and keep me safe from dangers big and small. I want to serve and do my best, no matter what the scene. I pledge to keep my skills refined, my judgment quick and keen. This calling to give of myself, most do not understand. But I stand ready all the time to help my fellow man. To have the chance to help a child restore his laugh with glee. A word of thanks I might not hear, but knowing is enough for me. The praise of men is fine for some, but I feel truly blessed that you, O Lord, have chosen me to serve in EMS. Let us pray. Almighty God, we just thank you, Father, for the people, Lord, that you put in our lives. And Bill is that such person that has given to you, Lord, and in turn given to us. And Lord, we just thank you for the time that he spent here and the things he was able to do with his life. And Lord, we ask you to help us to carry on, to do the things that he did, and to Lord, serve this community, serve our fellow man, to serve you most of all, Lord, to trust in you. And Lord, we just pray, Father, that if there's a question in our heart, is there anything out there, Lord, that I'm not doing that I should be doing, that we bring those things to you, Lord, that we ask you, Lord, to send someone to guide us, Lord. We need that sometimes. We need that guidance. I think Bill was that such a person that he helped people. He guided them. He sure helped me. Lord, I thank you for that. I thank you, Lord, for sending people in my life that has made my life a better place so that I can serve you, Lord. Lord, we just ask you to continue to bless this family, strengthen them, and know, Lord, that their loved one, that Bill, is with you now in paradise. No more worries, no more cares. Lord, he is in a beautiful place right now. We just thank you, Lord, for his life and what he did with it. We just pray these things and ask these things in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
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 concludes our graveside service. I thought we'd step out in the front of the tent and let folks speak to you there.